Now here we are going to see a problem from the topic riveted joints, and that is from the topic eccentrically loaded riveted joints. Let us see the problem. An eccentrically loaded lab riveted joint is to be designed for a steel bracket as shown in the figure. So this is the bracket for which you have to fix this bracket with the riveted joint from this 7 number of rivet, and this is the load acting on the bracket, and this is the eccentricity value, means this is the distance from the centroid of this system to the load acting point. So this is the given information or given diagram. So from this we have to find out the diameter of the rivet. So here some more data is given. The bracket plate is 25 mm thick. All rivets are of same size, means all the diameter of the rivets are same size that we have to take. And permissible shear stress is 65 MPa and crushing stress is 120 MPa. Determine the size of the rivet used for the joint. So here we have to find out the size of the rivet, nothing but we have to find out diameter of the rivet here. So let us see how we can do this problem. So here the given data is, thickness of the plate is given 25 mm and load acting is given 50 kN, and if you convert into newtons, that is 50 into 10 to the power of 3 newtons, and eccentricity value is given 400 mm. This is the eccentricity value, and permissible shear stress is given, that is 65 MPa, and you know that 1 MPa is 1 Newton per mm square. So it is 65 Newton per mm square, and permissible crushing stress 120 MPa, that is 120 Newton per mm square. So here we have to find out the size of the rivet D. So let us see how we can find out the diameter of the rivet. So to find out the diameter of the rivet, first of all we have to analyze the forces acting on the rivets. So why? Because suppose any machine element is given, when you want to design, so you will analyze the forces acting on the element, and you will find out the stresses, and you will equate the strength of the parts so that you can find out the dimension of the part. So in the same way here also, if you find, if you want to find out the diameter of the rivet, you have to analyze what are the forces acting on the rivet. So see here, the loading is given like this, means when the load is acting on the this system, this force will create, the external load will create two types of forces on rivets. That is, one kind of force is, so here one kind of force is direct shear load on each rivet, and that will be same on each rivet, and second force is nothing but secondary shear load, for which is proportional to the length between the center of the rivet to the centroid of the total system. So that is the magnitude. So means the magnitude of secondary shear force is proportional to the line joining between the center of the rivet to the centroid of the rivet system, and the direction of the secondary shear force is perpendicular to the line joining between these two centroid or and center of the rivet. So here this external load is creating two types of loads here. One is primary or direct shear load, which is same on each rivet, and other one is secondary shear loads, which will depend, or the magnitude of which depend upon the line joining the rivets center to the centroid of the system. So we have to find out this primary and secondary shear loads, and we have to find out the resultant between these two and on each rivet, and we have to find where the resultant force is more, on which rivet it is more. So we have to take maximum resultant force, and we have to equate this maximum resultant force to the strength of the rivet. So while doing that process here, I told the secondary shear load on each rivet is proportional to the line joining. Suppose if you take rivet number 1, so here F1 is the secondary shear load, so this will proportional to the line, this length L1, So because from the rivet 1, you are drawing a line to the centroid of the system. So this is L1, in the same way L2, L3, L4, L5, L6, L7. So this all these force, secondary forces are proportional to the corresponding length. So that we have written here F1 is proportional to L1, F2 is proportional to L2, F3 is proportional to L3, and so on, means F4, L4, like that. So from that we can write F1 by L1 is equals to F2 by L2 is equals to F3 by L3, and so on. So if you take first two terms, F1 by L1 is equals to F2 by L2, from this I can write F2 is F1 into L2 by L1. Similarly, I can write F3 is equals to first and this third term, means F3 is equals to L3 by L1 into F1, or F1 into L3 by L1. Like that, you can write F4 is equals to F1 into L4 by L1, and so on you can write. So as I told, to find out primary shear load, and this load is equally shared between m number of rivets. So here, how many number of rivets are given, you have to take, that is a n, or n is nothing but number of rivets. So here, to find out primary shear load, the total load divided by the number of rivets, such that you will get primary shear load on each rivet. And to find out the secondary shear loads, you have to equate the external moment, or moment created by the external load about center of gravity, to the sum of internal moments created by the secondary shear loads about the same center of gravity. So the external moment is P into E about the center of gravity. So how means it is P is the external load, which is acting at a distance of E eccentricity about the center of gravity. So this moment should be equals to the sum of internal moments created by the secondary shear loads to maintain equilibrium, or you can say that this produces the resisting forces. So if you take as resisting forces, you have to take in the reverse direction. So this is taken like this. So anyway, the total concept is here is to the sum of external load, external moment must be equals to the, at least it should be equals to the sum of internal moments created by the secondary loads to maintain the equilibrium here, or to avoid the failure of the rivet system. So from using that condition, we are finding out the secondary shear load on rivet number 1. So in that process, we are replacing F2, F3 as we written in the previous case, that is F2 is equals to F1 into L2 by L1, and is L1, L2 is already there, like F3 we are replacing by the equation of F1. So like that we are replacing, and if you simplify this, we'll get like this, F1 by L1, if you take out L1 here, so L1 square, and F1 by L1 take out means L2 square, L3 square, like that you'll get. And if you simplify this, you'll get F1, that is secondary shear load on rivet number 1, and from if you get F1, you can get F2, F3 by these equations up to F7, because 7 rivets are there. So to find out this F1, F2, F3, we require this lengths L1, L2, L3 up to L7, and to find out this lengths, we should know the exact location of the center of gravity here in the system. Because if you know this exact distance only, so we can find out L1 from this geometry. So to locate center of gravity, we know the basic formulas x bar y bar, that is a1 x1 plus a2 x2 plus and so on by a1 plus a2 plus n up to n, and the same way y bar a1 y1 plus a2 y2 plus a3 y3 and so on by a1 plus a2 plus a3 up to a7. So by using these two base formulas, we can locate the center of gravity, or we can find out the location of center of gravity. From that we can find out lengths. So after finding out the lengths, you can find out forces, and after that find out the resultant forces on each rivet. So the direct or primary shear load is acting vertically down, and this secondary shear loads are acting perpendicular to the lines. So these two forces are acting simultaneously on each rivet, means corresponding forces. So we have to find out the resultant between these two. So if you take theta is the angle between the primary force and secondary shear force. So if you take at the rivet number 1, this is the theta 1, theta 2 like that. Theta is the angle between the primary and the secondary shear loads. So we have to find out resultant of these two, primary and secondary, on each rivet, and we have to see where we are getting the maximum force or maximum resultant force. So that maximum force should be equal to the shear strength of the rivet. So we know shear strength of the rivet is nothing but cross section area, which is taking the shear force or shear stress or shear load, and multiplied by the shear strength of the rivet or allowable stress of the rivet, such that you will get shear strength of the rivet. So maximum force, if you equate to shear strength, you will get the diameter, and after getting the diameter, we will check this for the crushing stress. So we know formula, crushing stress is maximum load by crushing area. So by using this, we will calculate crushing stress, and if it is less than the permissible value or given value, we can say that the design is safe or the diameter is satisfactory. So this is the way we will find out or we will proceed with this problem. So to proceed with this problem, first of all, we have to find out x bar and y bar. So for the given system, let us assume x and y axis like this, and these are the 7 number of rivets arranged like this. So we are taking this x axis from the bottom rivets and y axis from this left rivets, and this is a given information only, 100 100 and 100 100 distance is given in the question. So if you write this x1 x6 x7, you know, x1 x6 x7 on same line, and from there only we are taking y axis means, so this distance you will get 0, and x2 is distance of this center from this one, so that is 100 from the geometry or from the diagram, you can write 100 x2, and x3 x4 x5 are on the same distance, means x3 x4 x5, so that is 200 here, 100 plus 100 200 means x3 x4 x5 is 200, and also y1 y2 y3, so this y1 y2 y3 means this distance from this x axis to the center distance, 3 are on the same height means, so that is nothing but 100 plus 100 means 200, so you will get y1 y2 y3 as 200, and y4 y7 as 100 here like, and y5 y6 as 0 from this diagram. And to find out x bar, we know the formula a1 x1 plus a2 x2 plus a3 x3 up to a7 x7 by a1 plus a2 plus a3 up to a7. So in the question it is given, all the rivets are of same size, means diameter is same, means areas is same, so I can write like this, a1 a2 a3 instead of, I can take same area means I can take common a term, so I can take out a common, means ax1 plus ax2 plus ax3 like this you will get, because area is common, and here also you will get a plus a 7 times, so this is a 7a, and I can take a common, so this is x1 x2 x3 up to x7, so a cancels, so this will be remaining x1 plus x2 plus x3 up to x7 by 7, and if you substitute those values, you have got here x2 100 like that, we have got all these x values, substitute those x values where you will get 0, means which value is there, you got x1 x2 x3, so substitute those values here and simplify, you will get x bar as 100 mm. So in the same way, y bar also, y1 plus y2 plus y3 up to y7 by 7, so substitute y values here, you will get y bar, and indicate in the diagram x bar value, that is 100, and y bar value 114.3 we got here, so indicate in the diagram. So here is the diagram, and in the next step we have to find out the lengths here. See, I told, so the length is the line joining between the center of the rivet to the center of gravity of the total rivet system here. So to find out this length, so just see this triangle. This triangle, we find out we require L1 first of all. So this is the right angle triangle, you know, from the diagram. So this is L1 is hypotenuse, and this is a side, and this is one more side. So you can write L1 square. And here from the geometry, you can say L1, L3 are same. Why? Because this is 100 and this is also 100. and so both are same triangles, similar triangles, so you can say L1 is equals to L3. So both are hypotenuse, means side square plus side square. And if you require this L, this is under root of, so 100 square, and this we require, we know from center to center 100 given, and from one more center to one more rivet center 100 given, and y bar we got 114.3. so but we require this distance, so this will be total 200 minus total 200, means from this center to this total 200 minus 114. If you do, you will get this is the remaining side length. So 100 under root of 100 square plus 200 minus 114.3, if you do, you will get the L1. So this we require, so total is 200. So friends, if you see here, total is 200, which is given in the diagram, from this center to from this rivet center to this rivet center 100, and this rivet center to this rivet center is 100 given in the question. So and y bar we got 114 mm, so but we require this distance only to find out L1. So this is anyway 100 given in the question. So to find out this, so total is 200 minus 114, so but it is under root. If you do under root of 100 square plus 200, if you do like this, you will get L1 and L3 same, and L2 means this distance, so it is directly 200 minus 114 200 minus 114.3. if you do, you will get L2 directly. So that is L2 value 85.7 mm. We got L4 and L7 are same from the geometry. If you see, L4 and L7 are same, this is 100, this is 100, and the same height, means you can say the similar triangles. So L4, L7 are same, so we can write once again, this L4, L7 becomes hypotenuse from these triangles, or these two kind of triangles, if you observe the cursor. So this is the triangle, this is one more triangle, both are same 100 distance. So L4, L7 same, so you can find out L4 is under root of 100 square plus this distance we require. This is the one more side of this triangle, small triangle. So how you get this, means from here to here it is y bar, that is 114.3 mm. So from that, if you remove 100 here, so this from here to here is 100, so we require this distance. So you know this total from here to here, observe the cursor here, so here to here is 114, and if you remove this 100 from the diagram, you will get this distance which we require. So L4 is equals to under root of 100 square plus 114 minus 100, 114 minus 100, if you will get this distance. So that we are doing here. So L4 and L7 are same, so if you simplify that, you will get 101 mm, and L5, L6 are same from the diagram. If you see, L5, L6 are same. So to find out L5, so once again this is 100, if you see here 100, so this here also 100 here. So L5 is equal to under root of 100 square plus 114 square, so this is the triangle here we require. L5 means L5, L6 same, so means here L5 is equal to under root of 100 square plus 114.3 square. So if you do like that, you will get L5, L6 as 152 mm. So after getting the lengths, find out the primary shear load on each rivet, so that is total load by n number of rivets, that is 7 rivets. So total load is, external load is 50 kilonewtons, or 50 into 10 to the power of 3 newtons by n number of rivets, means 7 number of rivets, that is you are getting primary shear load as 7143 newtons. And to find out the secondary shear load, I told we have to equate the moment created by the external load to the sum of the moments created by the secondary shear force about the center of gravity. So that we have seen formula, that is P into E will give the external load, and these F1 L1 plus F2 L2 plus F3 L3 will give the secondary, means moments created by the secondary shear forces about the center of gravity. These two must be, so as I told, so these two must be equal to maintain the equilibrium or to avoid the failure of the rivet. To satisfy that, so we are equating the external moment to the sum of the moments created by the secondary forces. So if you do like this, we have already explained. So you can write like this: F1 by L1 is equals to L1 square, L2 square, L3 square. So if you see here, L1 and L3 are same. So instead of writing L1, L3 two times of L1 square, L2 is L2 square only, and L4, if you see here, L4, L7 are same. So replacing L4, L7 by L4, so two times of L4 square, L5, L6 are same here, 152. So replacing L6 as L5, so it is two times of L5 square. And if you substitute all those length values here, and if you simplify by substituting the external load value and eccentricity value, we'll get F1, that is a secondary shear load on rivet number 1. And from this formulas which we discussed earlier, we'll get F2 value. It is F1 into L2 by L1. L2 we got 85.7, L1 we got 131.7. From this we'll see L1, L3 are same, 131.7, L2 85.7, L4, L7 101 mm, L5, L6 152 mm. So we are substituting those to get F2, and we are getting F2 as 15,776 newtons. And the same way F3, substitute those values. So because L1 and L3 are same, so this cancels, means F3 is equals to F1. So same value, 24,244 newtons. And F4 value, substitute values, and get, we are getting like this, 18,593. And F5, as substitute F1 into these values, L5 and L1, we are getting 27,981 newtons. And F6, as same, L5, L6 are same, means we are getting F5, F6 as same. And F7, substitute these values to get F7. So L4, L7 are same, so we get F4 and F7 as same. So after getting secondary shear forces, so if you observe the F3, F4 and F5 here, F3 is 24,000 some value, 24,000 plus, and F4 18,000, and F5 27,000. So here the maximum values are 27,000 from this all force values, 24 plus 15 plus, or means 24,000 plus value, and it is 15,000 plus value, 24,000 plus value, 18,000 plus value, 27,000 plus value, 27,000, these two are same, and 18,000 plus. So maximum force is F5. And here also, if you observe the diagram here, so anyway, F5 is same, and also from this diagram, so from this diagram, the theta 3, theta 4, theta 5 are less, means the included angle between F3 PS at the 3, means theta 3, theta 4, theta 5, we are getting less values. So if we are getting these theta values less, means we are getting resultant forces more. So why? Because we know to solve, first of all, to solve this, we will take as a help of parallelogram law formula, that is some F1 square, F2 square, that is resultant is equal to under root of F1 square plus F2 square plus 2 into F1 F2 cos theta. So when theta is less value, cos theta is more, you know. So when cos theta is more, so the resultant is also more. So finally, you can say that when the theta is less, generally you can find out more resultant value. So, and also the secondary loads is, if you observe F3, F4, F5 are more when you compare with other values. So in that, F5 is more. So to reduce the procedure, so this is the logic we follow. So where you are finding out the theta values less, means included angle less values, and where you are getting the secondary shear load more. So combiningly, means by combining those, we are finding out the resultants at our resultant forces R3, R4, R5. So that is the logic, means where you are finding less theta values and more resultant secondary shear load values. So find out only those resultants R3, R4, R5 to reduce the length of the problem. So here also we are doing same thing. We are only finding out, we are saying that 3, 4, 5 are heavily loaded, and so that to find out the resultant, we require cos theta value. So we are finding out only theta 3, theta 4, theta 5 values, So how means from the diagram, if you see from the diagram, this is theta 3, and to find out this theta 3, just observe this. So this is a triangle here, and this is the 90 degrees. So first only we have explained. So the secondary shear load is perpendicular to the line joining. That is the assumption we have made, or that from that only we have proceeded. So this and this are perpendicular. The L3 line and F3 are perpendicular. Means so this angle between these two is 90 degrees. So this theta 3, if this is the theta 3, so this will become 90 minus theta 3, because total is 90. So this will become 90 minus theta 3. If this is 90 minus theta 3, this is 90, this will be theta 3. So why because suppose, to explain better way, so suppose if I take only this triangle separately, let us, so same triangle we have taken separately, so this is the theta 3, and this two angle between these two is 90, means this will become 90 minus theta 3. So if this is 90 minus theta 3 and this is 90 anyway, so this should be once again theta 3. Why? Because suppose let us say this is theta 3, instead of theta 3 let us take theta only. So if it is theta, it is 90 minus theta, this is 90, and it should become theta. So if don't know, let us assume x, this one, this is 90 minus theta we got, this is 90. So 90 minus theta plus 90, this is x. If you assume, so the total angle in the triangle is 180 degrees. So if you simplify this, you will get x is theta only. So that is, if it is, here is theta, 90 minus theta here, and if it is 90 minus theta, it is theta here. So anyway, this is some clue, small clue to calculate this theta from those geometry. So if you see the diagram here, so this will be theta 3, means so here also this angle also theta 3. So if you observe this triangle, cos theta 3, you can write adjacent side by hypotenuse from the basic formula. So adjacent side will be 100 here, and hypotenuse will be L3. So cos theta 3 is 100 by L3. So that we have written cos theta 3 is 100 by L3. L3 value is 131.7 we got in the previous case. If you simplify, you will get cos theta 3 as 0.76. So in the similar way, theta 4. So see here. So this, observe this small triangle. So this actually theta 4 is the angle between F4 and this PS at this place. So if this is theta 4 and this is 90 and this is some x, so see here, this is theta 4, this is 90, this is x. So if you add this x plus 90 plus theta 4, it should be 180. Means because this is a 180 degrees, means it's a straight line. So this half of the angle is 180, you know. So that is theta 4 plus 90 plus some this x is 180, such that if you get this, you can calculate this here, that will anyway you get theta 4. That let us see how you get theta 4. So for that, just take only this small triangle separately. I'm taking here the small triangle separately. So this is a theta 4, this is 90, and this is x we have assumed. So x plus 90 plus theta 4 should be 180, I have told. So to find out x, means to find out this angle, so if you send this side, it is a 90 minus theta 4 here. So x value is 90 minus theta 4, and this is 90 here, 90 minus theta 4, 90. So we'll get this is a theta 4 anyway. So finally, this is theta 4, means cos theta 4 will be adjacent by hypotenuse. Adjacent is 100, from here it is 100. Hypotenuse L4. So cos theta 4 is 100 by L4. So if you simplify that, you will get 0.99 as cos theta 4. And in the same way, proceed with the cos theta 5. So if you see the diagram, this is the theta 5. We require cos theta 5, means how you find out. First of all, let us see, from here to here it is 90. From this line to this is 90, you know, from geometry or from the diagram, you know. So if it's theta 5, means it is 90 minus theta 5. If it is 90 minus theta 5, means it is theta 5. Why? Because once again, from here to here it is 90 degrees. If 90 minus theta 5, this is theta 5. So if it is theta phi, so cos theta phi is nothing but adjacent, this by hypotenuse L phi, means 100 by L phi. So that we can see separately in the, so if you see this L phi theta phi here, 90 minus theta phi, means this is once again theta phi. Why? Because here this is a L phi and this is the perpendicular F phi. So this is, this should be 90. So anyway, you got this 90 minus theta phi, means it should be theta phi. And this 100 we got from the geometry, and this L phi. So cos theta phi from this triangle is adjacent, that is 100 by L phi. 100 by L5 means 100 by L5 value 152. So you will get 0.658 as a cos theta 5 value. So after getting cos theta 3, theta 4, theta 5, find out the resultants R3, R4, R5. So we know, I told, so from the diagram, by using the parallelogram law formula, means these two sides as a parallelogram, adjacent sides of the parallelogram. So if you use, you can apply parallelogram law here to find out the resultant. The parallelogram law resultant at the rivet number 3 is nothing but under root of PS square F3 square. PS is the direct shear load and F3 is the secondary shear load on rivet number 3. PS square F3 square plus 2 PS F3 cos theta 3 angle between those two. Substitute the values. And if you simplify, you get 30,033 newtons. So in the same way, R4 PS square plus F4 square plus 2 PS F4 cos theta 4. Substitute the values we got in the previous case. And if you simplify that, you will get 25,684 newtons. And in the same way, find out R5 PS square phi F square plus 2 PS FS cos theta 5. Simplify, if you simplify, you get 33,121. Newtons. So if you observe these three, it is 30,000 some value R3, 25,000 some value R4, and it is 33,000 R5. So from these three also, once again R5 you are getting the maximum value. So R5 is the maximum load, or it is a maximum resultant load or maximum load that can act on the total rivets. So equate this maximum load to the strength of rivet, that is pi by 4 d square into tau. So this is the, if the shear load, it will fail like this. So this is the area, shear area. So to get shear strength, you know, area multiplied by the allowable shear stress, pi by 4 d square into tau. So that equate to the maximum load acting on the rivets, such that you will get the diameter of the rivet. So here we are getting diameter as, by substituting the values, 65 is the allowable shear stress value, which is given in the question in the starting. So 33 we got here only. 33,121 newtons. So if you simplify that, you will get diameter as 25.5 mm. And check this diameter for the allowable crushing stress criteria. So you will write stress is load by area. So load is maximum load and crushing area. If you see, this is the plate here. Suppose the plate is in the vertical direction only, but for our convenience we have drawn like this. Thickness of the plate like this given, and this is one more direction. And here, if you suppose it is a half section of the plate, so here you will insert a rivet. So when you are applying the load on the rivet system, so this rivet will be pressed with this wall, or wall, and at the same time wall will apply compressive load on the rivet surface, and the rivet surface will also apply the compressive load on this area. So this, what is this area, means if you project this, so this is the diameter and this is the thickness. So it's a rectangle area, so that nothing but it is a D into T. So where this will compress each other, means plate will apply compressive force on rivet, and at the same time rivet also will apply compressive force on this area. So which is nothing but, which is called crushing failure. So to find out stress, load by crushing area, that is crushing area is projected area here, D multiplied by T. So load is this maximum load only, 33,121. And if you do that, we are getting 51.95 Newton per mm square. So this is the induced crushing stress in the rivet, that is less than the allowable value only. That is, allowable value for this rivet is 120 megapascal, which is given, or Newton per mm square, which is given in the question. So we are getting 51.95, which is less than the allowable value or permissible value. So you can say that the rivet can withstand crushing load also. So you can say that it is a safe design. So this is the way you have to do this eccentrically loaded riveted joints. So if it is sigma c, suppose in the question not given, so you can stop at this place only by equating the shear strength to the maximum load. You can find out diameter, and if you want standard values, you can refer tables of rivets, tables such that you can find out the standard diameters. So this is the way to proceed with this eccentrically loaded riveted joints. So for more videos, please subscribe and activate bell symbol. Like it, share it, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.